Yeah, it's a smear campaign, but you know, I'm not going to play that game with them. They can do it all they want. They're going to go back and try to find anything that I've ever said and try to get me on the defensive about it in order to distract away from the things that are important.
I was offered a full scholarship to West Point, got to meet General Westmoreland, go to Congressional Medal of Honor dinners, but decided really my pathway would be medicine.
Well, this dominated a lot of the day in political journalism. Dr. Ben Carson defending, and his campaign defending, what he wrote in his book about what he called getting a full scholarship. Of course, to West Point, you don't get scholarships, you get appointments. And the campaign kind of had a couple of statements today. They started out with the original statement this morning, saying Dr. Carson was the top ROTC student in the city of Detroit. In that role, he was invited to meet General Westmoreland. He believes it was at a banquet. He can't remember with specificity their brief conversation, but it centered around Dr. Carson's performance as ROTC city executive officer. He was introduced to folks from West Point by his ROTC supervisors. They told him they could help him get an appointment based on his grades and performance in ROTC. He considered it, but in the end did not seek admission. Then it developed, and later in the day, after a Politico story, the Politico story is an outright lie. Dr. Carson, as the leading ROTC student in Detroit, was told by his commanders that he could get an appointment to the academy. He never said he was admitted or even applied. The campaign never admitted to anything. This is what we have come to expect from Politico. So why the focus on these semantics? Well, let's talk about it all with the panel. Syndicated columnist George Will, David Cantonese, senior politics writer for the U.S. News and World Report, and Charles Hurt, political columnist for the Washington Times. Okay, Charlie, much to do about nothing?
Well, at the very least, it's, you know, he was imprecise about something. He did get something wrong in his book and in his statements. But I would actually argue that more than anything, it's sort of an editing mistake that should have been corrected back when he wrote the book, and they were trying to recreate something that had happened 45 years before. But whether or not this hurts him or not, I have to say, you know, my goodness, could he have picked a better enemy to get into a fight with in this primary than the media? And, of course, Politico of all, just because Politico very much is a sort of inside the beltway sort of media outlet, and getting into a fight with them, good. It's all good. It's all good for Ben Carson.
He told Bill O'Reilly, David, that he just was told that it would be very easy for him to get in, and he should have clarified that it wasn't a full scholarship. I mean, it was all over the place today.
It was amazing to see how it unraveled online within 5 hours. This guy was dead man walking when this Politico story hit, conservatives abandoning him, and then you saw the retractions. Politico had to change their story and their headline that said he fabricated the specific allegation. And what really the difference was is that he said he never applied to West Point, and he never said he applied. He said he was offered a scholarship informally in this meeting. But now conservatives are rallying to him, and to Charlie's point, now Carson, I think, has won this news cycle. When 5 hours ago you thought he lost it and he might be at the end of his campaign.
Pretty remarkable. And just in context, 1969, a time when West Point was trying, George, to get more African-American men as a part of the U.S. Military Academy. And that's the context there. What about this as we see it develop through the day?
I think it can be imprecise speaking and foggy memory, neither of which is terribly culpable. But when your biography is your campaign, as his is more than any other, then you better get it right if you're saying, elect me president because of my life story. He speaks in such modulated, dulcet tones that we tend to sometimes miss some of the harsh things he's saying. He burst upon the scene at the 2013 prayer breakfast when he did something that really was inappropriate, I think. He lectured the president sitting next to him on the defects of Obamacare. In 1992, and this is going to be an issue before long, he changed sides, essentially, on a referendum on abortion in Maryland between the pro-life, he went over to the pro-choice sides. He has said in this campaign he would use the Education Department to monitor the political biases on colleges and universities, which is dubious idea. He says we live in a Gestapo age, which we really don't. He said people taking the new advanced placement history test will be ready to sign up for ISIS, which I doubt. He said of Obamacare, it is, in a way, slavery. And before the 2014 elections, he said if the Republicans don't capture the Senate, there might not be 2016 elections. So he's got a rhetorical record that's going to get more scrutiny.
And look, the vetting is going to take place, and I think this was a warning shot to the Carson campaign. This might have been planted by an opposing campaign. We don't know.
Might have been. But really?
I mean, you covered this thing. But I mean, look. This, I do believe the vetting is going to be tough for him, and I don't know if he's ready for it because of the way he speaks. But when you're a media outlet and you land a hit like that, it better be clean. Because these days, people already have wide, vast distrust of the media, as you said, of D.C. outlets especially. And I saw it online unfurled today. The conservatives are now with Carson, and they're against the media when this looked like, wow, he was fabricating it. Because they got a little part of it wrong, that's just enough to incite them.
Let's talk about the debate coming up. FBN debate on Tuesday. It is going to be a little different. And Chris Christie goes from the main stage to the second stage. There you see the first tier, and then the second stage, which is the undercard, which actually happens first, will be four candidates now, Santorum, Christie, Huckabee, and Jindal. Chris Christie reacting today.
The fact is, wherever they put a podium and a camera and a national television audience, I will be there wherever they ask me to be, and I will debate and talk about the issues. I'd love to be put back on the main stage, but I'm not a whiner or a moaner or a complainer. You know, they made their decision. I don't agree with it, but they made their decision. So I'm going to do whatever it is I am supposed to do on Tuesday night.
Okay. Charlie.
I mean, this is rough for Chris Christie because, you know, I think that probably the finest moment of his campaign so far was the last debate where he landed a very nice hit on not only on the media, you know, getting into that beatdown fest, but also laid out Jeb Bush pretty good for his answer about the fantasy football. And so he had a great that was great. And but before, you know, he could even get any sort of liftoff from that, the terribleness of his campaign up to this point dragged him back down so that he does, you know, so that he loses this big spotlight. Who knows whether he can do anything on the undercard to actually get back into the fight.
Deb.
This is something I agree with Donald Trump on. I think there has to be a winnowing of this process. There have been three debates now and three undercard debates.
Although I will point out, he tweeted out today that he thinks that Christie and Huckabee should be back on the stage.
If Christie and Huckabee were at 20%, you know, I think he may not be, you know, tweeting about who he believes should. He doesn't see them as threats right now. But I think, look, these guys have been campaigning for 6 months, and if you're at 0 or 1% in the polls, I think the media has the right to say, you know what? You're not allowed in this one. We've had three.
Quickly, we should point out Alabama closed its balloting process filing. George Pataki and Jim Gilmore did not qualify, and so they will not be on the Alabama ballot if they're going that far. We're watching these balloting processes very closely because that'll tell you about campaigns and their logistics.
Yeah, running a campaign does replicate governing in the sense you have to do a lot of things fast and you have to look across a complicated country, and those guys failed the first test.